Hello, it's Scott Manley here, and today we are continuing our playthrough of, Kerbal Space Program for beginners. And, at this point we have a lot of science to return from Duna, and it takes a very, very long time because those dinky little solar panels don't really generate a huge amount of power. Basically, transmitting science back tends to be a constant battle of the charge being depleted through the transmitters and being replenished very slowly by the solar panels. As long as you have time, that's all good. Anyway, eventually, we have transmitted all the science and it's finally time to deploy the rover. So the rover will just come out of there nicely. Look at that. I have to say, I'm pretty chuffed with this. I think this is a nice little design. It's probably not as... It's not particularly mass efficient. So we're going to turn this thing around and start heading... Oh no, wait a second. Yes, I turned it around and I should have turned it around again. Anyway, we are going to go north. Go north, young man, to the lands where the hills are pink. Yes, as you travel north, you're going to transition from the regular terrain into the polar terrain, and as you transit, the color will be interpolated from the reddish colors of the land to the white colors of the pole, and in between you get pink. And interestingly enough, this of course is how the biomes work as well. The biomes are defined by a color map, and the color map is also interpolated by the code, which means that between the color that defines the lowlands and the color that defines the poles, it's gonna have some sort of transition and give us craters. Okay, so obviously I've been doing this at a faster than regular speed just to give you, just so you don't have to watch the entire drive. Yes, so between these, between biomes, you will sometimes find a phantom biome, which of course you can collect data from if you like. This is the craters in this case. Perfectly good. We're going to sit here and collect all the data we need to, all the data we can before we proceed to the pole proper. This is true everywhere. If you are on Kerbin and you get, as you're leaving the space center, there's a transition zone between the space center and the grasslands, which magically gives you tundra. And of course, you can collect that data, and that's all going to be very good, and it'll help you expand your space program. Anyway, having uploaded all this, it's time to move out and head onwards towards the pole. Now, while I chose the pole because it was easy to see where the transition between the biomes were, that has the downside of being so far north that the solar panels don't work so well. Thankfully, I'm making a point of parking on a downhill slope, or a hill that slopes southward, so at least my solar panels get a little more power and I have to spend a little less time actually watching this. They do this with the real Mars rovers, incidentally. They'll park them on slopes which face towards the sun a little, just to maximize their production during winter. Anyway, with this mission complete, it's time to think about the next thing. So, I also went to the moon, got all the science from there, and I've got about 2,000 science! Oh, hallelujah! So I want to build a spaceplane. I think this is where we need to go. So we need supersonic flight, and we need these whiplash turbo ramjet engines. Those are the engines you need if you want to go like Mach 3. And you want to go at least that fast if you're building a rocket that goes to space. What else? We're going to build precision engineering. That's nice for space probes. This is nice for power. Don't really need those. Survey scanners. Let's bring that. We can take a look at ore and, in situ resource utilization in a future episode. The nuclear engine, which I've just selected, is hugely important and should always be unlocked because it will really help you with your rocket efficiency. So yeah, I guess we're just going to expand out our space plane program. Yeah, I'm not going to build the Mark II stuff. I don't really need that. Or that Mark III or whatever. I don't really need big space plane just yet. I'm going for the small ones. That might be nice. I think I'm just going to get all of these ones at the 150 or 160 science level. And that leaves me 335. And, you know, I don't really see anything here that I absolutely must have right now. The 3.5 meter structural parts, docking stuff. Not really. I don't really need the big tanks either. And... yeah, I just don't see the point of going with this thing other than that fairing. I'm not ready for 3.75 meter rockets. So you know what? I think I'm going to leave this science around because I'd like to unlock some other stuff further down the line with a little more science. But I need to, of course, upgrade the R&D building to get access. Okay, so we're decided. We're going to go and we're going to build a space plane. And the space plane, of course, gets built in this hangar here. Okay, we're going to start this with the Mark II cockpit. We're going to build something that has a cargo bay. And we want it to get to orbit. And you know what? I've just realized that I need to upgrade my spaceplane hangar so that I can build something with 30 or worth more than 30 parts. I could probably build a spaceplane with fewer parts, but I think I can afford the upgrade cost. 225,000. Yes, I think I will pay that. Okay, back into the hangar. Okay, so I've previously covered building aircraft, and the same rules still apply. You know, you gotta watch your center of mass versus center of lift. But you're also gonna need way more fuel than you expect, right? So, especially if you've watched my other episodes. First of all, the engines were nerfed a little. Secondly, a lot of my other episodes with space planes were in Interstellar Quest, and everything was nuclear powered. I put in a first fuel tank there with a cargo bay right behind it. There's a large one and there's a small one. The large one is twice as big, so you probably just want the large one at the very least. That gives you room for something. Then I'm going to build this backwards. Now, the reason I have fuel in front and behind the cargo bay is because it will let me pump the fuel back and forth to provide stability control. And you've got to make sure that you are getting the rocket fuel tanks rather than the aviation fuel tanks, right? You need to have rocket fuel and oxidizer all the way into space. Okay, now I'm going to use the LVT-45. These are heavier engines with less thrust. The upside here is they have better efficiency. They also have gimballing, which will help with controls, but it's the efficiency I need. Okay, so for the jet engines, we're going to mount these on fuel tanks down the side. Now, I'm going to use rocket fuel tanks here because this is a place to store more rocket fuel. So we're going to put two of these on the side. These are the turbojets. They are able to go up to about 1100 meters per second before they really start losing thrust. And you're going to make sure you want to pump the fuel inwards using fuel lines there. So I'm going to just reduce the amount of oxidizer in these tanks just because some of this will be burned off only as fuel, right? So the jet engines will only burn fuel, so we can get rid of some of the oxidizer so that we're not carrying it into orbit. We're going to use the big RAM intakes, and in Kerbal Space Program 1.0, you no longer need to play, or it's not no longer such an advantage to play with intake spam, so I'm just having one set of intakes. Now, the wings, you want the wings to start quite a long way back, because again, you need your center of lift to be behind your center of mass. Very important, so I'm trying to put, you know, move everything back as much as possible here. The Kerbal Space Program 1.0 model, aerodynamics model, now includes body lift, so that nose will actually provide a lot of lift or a lot of drag once it starts to pull up, so we have to be very much aware of that, especially since it's going to have that big hollow area in it. And I cannot figure out the way to rotate these flaps ever. Yes, it's a case of randomly hitting QWEASD randomly until it rotates the right way. And while we're here, I'm going to disable some of these controls. We don't get yaw on the wings. We turn the yaw off, and in some of those I turn off roll, because having every single pitch-capable flap providing roll provides a spacecraft that rotates far too quickly. The tailplane should be as far back as possible. Wait a second. Okay. Old me. I've got to call you on this. So, hi, this is new me. This is me after the video was recorded. So, I have to interject here. Old me was doing his thing, and new me has noticed that old me, he basically went in and disabled yaw on his tailplane. So that is a ridiculously stupid thing to do, and it will make the aircraft really hard to fly. However, I've only just noticed this now, so clearly old me managed to pull off the mission. But if you are looking at this and using this as a guide to build your airplane, do not disable yaw on your tailplane. Instead, you want to disable pitch and roll and keep the yaw enabled. Otherwise, you will have a hard time flying it. Anyway, back to old me. And make sure you adjust the control allocations for those tailplanes as well. Now, the delta V here is 2.4, but what I'm going to do is fix my staging here so that Kerbal Engineer has a better idea. Anyway, for stability, we click on center of mass and center of lift. Now, the blue is center of lift. That is in front of the center of mass, and that is a really bad place for it to be. Technically, it's the center of aerodynamic drag. Now, so what I'm going to do is move this backwards so that my wings go backwards. And that hasn't really changed very much because there's a lot of fuel in there. Okay, and those wings are sitting rather far forwards here. Okay, so I guess I'm going to do some adjustments here. Take those wings and move those further back. Back, back, back. Now we're getting into territory where this thing should actually fly. If I want to pull these little front wings back, I need to take off the intakes because so I can access the hull. Let's try that. There. Now that is just slightly behind and no more. I think, okay, if I fix this, yes, I think that should be flyable. Now the only thing is, that is with all the fuel in it, so we need to actually try and see how this performs when it's empty. Because after you're coming back from space, you will have no fuel in it. And it's quite common to build a space plane that as you fly into space, it's great, it gets into orbit, does its mission, and then, oh, wait, I apparently had removed fuel from that already. Okay, so the idea is I'm removing fuel from this so that we know whether it will be able to land with essentially zero fuel left. Oh, yes, now you get that out of there. Zero fuel. It's close, but I think it's okay. I think we will be able to survive that. I'm just going to move this back just a touch. Now, I should probably put in the extra bits of hardware just so the mass is added. The battery pack, we're going to have some batteries here in the cargo bay just to make sure that we can run through our orbit and survive, you know. We can fly around without worrying too much. We're going to have a Clampatron Jr. inside the cargo bay there for holding payloads. Close that up now. Not that that's going to affect my mass distribution or anything. We are going to need to have some landing gear. And I guess, being an old-fashioned type of person, I'm using the old Kerbal Space Program landing gear. There we go. Make sure they're straight. And oh, yeah, no, make sure they're straight. Now, actually, what we want to do is put these between the center of mass and the rear of the wings. And there's a trade-off here. If you move them too far forwards or too far back, then it becomes very hard to lift the nose up. If you move them too far forwards, then there's a pretty good chance you will scrape your engines. So pick a position and pray that you don't mess things up. Okay. So I think that's in the right place. Let's put some liquid fuel in this thing and actually try flying it around. So I'm just going to put liquid fuel in there, save that. And that does not look like it's too good. I'm going to instead put the liquid fuel into this. Tiny amount of liquid fuel in there just to make sure I can get it off the runway, and then we'll, you know, test it and everything. For the purposes of saving, I'm going to call this Spaceplane Test, appropriately enough. Save this. And I just realized we need some solar panels on here, because otherwise in space it has no way to generate power. We just need a couple of those. And now we're ready to launch. Take it in. Oh no, it's actually too big for the runway. I need to go and upgrade my runway as well. Wow, that's the second time I've tried to do something and forgot that I needed to upgrade something, huh? Come on. Yes. Hello? Are you going to load? Oh, thank you. There, up you go. Upgrade, and then back into the space plane hangar. And when this loads, we shall be able to send the crew out on a test flight. So this is essentially a dry run, as in the tanks are almost all dry. The aircraft is very light. We have a little bit of fuel and it's just for those jet engines. I just want to make sure that the aircraft is not going to be completely uncontrollable when it's returning from space, because that is a really bad time to learn that your spacecraft is unflyable. This is looking good. Look, we're pulling into a serious climb here. Just about Mach 1. Yes, look at that, breaking through the sound barrier here. Sweet. Look at those G-forces there. That's stunning. Fabulous. Okay, I think we have proven that this flies, so we'll get ready to turn back around once we've cleared enough altitude. Throttle back just a touch. Oh, wait a second, that sounded like a flame out. Whoa, ho, ho, ho. Look at that thing turn! This flies beautifully. Yeah, flame out. Oh yeah, I didn't pack enough liquid fuel for a real test, so I guess I'm gonna see if I can glide this thing back. That's always fun. So now a real dry run with no fuel. I had totally not intended for this to happen. Of course, I could just press escape and revert to, you know, the launch bay or whatever, but why not? I mean, this is what it's all about. You are going to have to learn to land this thing. So I'm essentially gliding down here in a very steep slope, around 40 degrees. I'm aiming slightly in front of the runway because what I'm going to do is pull up towards the end. That's called a flare, and it's going to be a very hard pull up. The idea is that we're going to stall the wings, and that's really going to put a lot of drag on it and slow me down. I'm moving at 177 meters per second, which is really fast. There we go. Look at that. See that? So we're still going 150. I'm going to pull a little harder. Yeah, look at that. You see those G-forces there? Bleeding off speed every time I turn. And oh, this is a little unstable. Okay. Yeah, we're still flying, and the speed is now down to 70 meters per second. See? Totally meant to do that. Now, gently put this thing onto the tarmac. Look at that. Is that not a gentle touchdown? I mean, if you cut out the rest of it, that would be a super gentle touchdown. Okay, so this thing lands perfectly. Now we're going to actually have to develop into a viable launch vehicle. We're going to go and do that in the next episode. But until then, I'm Scott Manley. Fly safe.